You have the power. You can make people believe. Just tell your story. Tell us what happened when you met Bigfoot. Type it up and send it in to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I'll get it narrated, put up here on the channel, and then people everywhere will hear your story. And they too will come to believe. Well, hey there, everybody. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. I don't have much of a preamble tonight. I'm going to take the advice of someone I really trust and admired. So, let's just get down to some business. What do you say? Hi, my name is Jack Featherstone. I'm from northern British Columbia and First Nation. My story is from the 70s on Highway 16 on the Skeena. There was a lady who had her relationship ended and was devastated about losing her boyfriend and spent her time crying. She didn't eat, but cry. She would walk the highway at night crying, and this led to her disappearance. People seen her only walking and crying, and that was the last time seeing her. The natives believe that Bigfoot had pity on her and took her away. First Nations believe they have the power to mind-convince humans to follow them and take them. To this day, some people blame the Highway of Tears on Highway 16. Thank you for your time, and good night. Hello, Nance. My name is Joe. I hope all is well with you. To say I love your channel, that would be a great understatement. Just here recently on an 8-hour trip, we listened to about 15 to 20 hours of your YouTube videos. Me and my kids, we love listening. You do a great job narrating. Keeping 4 teenagers and a 20-year-old son interested was impressive. Well, here are my encounters. It was about October 2013. I was working third shift. I live in southern Indiana out in the country. Closest neighbor is about a half mile down the road on either side. Woods are between us and the neighbors on one side, and a big wooded hill and about 80 feet high on the other side. There are hundreds of wooded acres behind us, and this is where I saw it. I was walking out to my car going to work. It was about 10 p.m. I think it was cloudy that night because I don't remember seeing the stars or moon. It was pitch dark. We don't have one of those security lights because I love the night sky. And those security lights, they just mess up the view. I just use a little flashlight to see where I'm going. So I got about 6 to 8 feet lit up in front of me. I got about halfway to my car, and I noticed these two bright red lights way up in this tree on the edge of the woods in my backyard. I thought, huh, cool lights. Then I saw them blink. They were huge, round, red eyes up in that tree. I stopped and I thought, what is that? I didn't hear anything. I mean, nothing. It was so quiet. Then I remembered seeing a big owl that was flying around snatching squirrels. I seen it fly through the woods and snatch a squirrel off a branch that summer. So I thought, that must be that owl up there. So I was just watching it for a few minutes, and it just kept looking at me. Then I saw it turn its head a few times, like it was looking at something behind it, but always turning back to look at me. Then the eyes just disappeared, and I thought, wow, how lucky was I to see that? Then a few seconds after the eyes disappeared, I heard what sounded like a branch snap, then a huge crashing sound, and a big thud that I felt more than I heard. Then what sounded like a freight train crashing through the woods moving fast. I stood still in shock, wondering, what just happened? Then I snapped out of it and I thought, I need to get in the car, now. By the time I got in the car, I didn't see or hear anything. Whatever it was has ran deeper into the woods. I said to myself, that was no owl. I never heard anything make that much noise. When it was running, it sounded like the trees were snapping. The next morning I got home, and I saw smaller trees broken in the area that I heard whatever it was. I wasn't going to go any deeper. I figured, it left me alone, and I will leave it alone. I told people about this, and they think I'm crazy or something. It's nice to be able to tell someone without being judged. Whatever it was a lot bigger than anything I know of around here. Not long after that, I moved to day shift at my work. One morning driving to work, I drove past this creek that I have driven past thousands of times. The creek always floods after a heavy rain, but most of the time it has a small stream in it. The creek is about 10 to 15 feet wide and has banks about 4 to 5 feet high. It was pretty much dry at this time, and I have never seen anything in that creek besides the creek rocks. But on this morning, I saw something black in that creek. The closer I got, I saw how huge it was. It looked like how a gorilla that I had seen at a zoo sits, but this thing was huge. It took up about half the creek bed, and it was taller than the creek banks, and it looked like it was sitting. As I drove by it, there were trees in the way, so I lost sight of it. I stopped, and I turned around to go back to see what it was. And it was gone. Only the creek rocks there. Nothing around. I knew we had black bears coming into our area, but they don't get near that big. I had a good look at it as I was driving up to it, but it looked like I was looking at the back of a gorilla, solid black and hairy. A couple of months later, on the interstate exit I take to go home coming from work, I saw something chase a deer across both the east and westbound lanes of I-64. This exit is about 5 miles from where I saw that thing sitting in the creek. I was about a quarter mile from the exit. I had clear vision of both east and westbound lanes as well as the bridge going across the interstate. That is when I saw the deer booking it across the interstate. It ran over the bank at my exit, and I could tell exactly where it crossed because of the white lines on the road and the off-ramp. I could tell it ran right past a speed limit sign for the off-ramp. Just about the time the deer reached that sign, I saw something black come up from the other side of the interstate chasing that deer. I could tell it was running faster than the deer, and I thought to myself, it's going to catch it. I watched as that black thing crossed the interstate road and ran across my exit. I saw where it crossed my exit the same way I saw the deer. That thing ran over the third cross line that the state put between the road and the off-ramp. That third line was right across from the speed limit sign the deer passed by, and that black thing passed by the sign. All this happened in seconds, but I got a good clear view of this chase. They were both in the woods by the time I got to my exit. I stopped at that speed limit sign to check if I could see anything. I couldn't see either of them. I looked at that speed limit sign and I thought to myself, no way. I got out. And I stood next to that sign, and it was at least 8 feet tall. That black thing was as tall as that sign. I hurried, and I got back in my car. I took off, and I thanked the Lord that I was heading south, and that thing was running north. I don't know what it was. Nothing around here gets that big. The only thing I thought of was a Bigfoot or a dog man. Then I remember years before these sightings, I had had my kids on the Ohio River bank on the Indiana side fishing one clear night. The moon was shining on the river, and it was beautiful. It was quiet, and we were having a great time fishing. I heard what I thought sounded kind of like elk's call out, but it was different. I know some elks were released in Kentucky, but I didn't think they were that far north. But I thought, cool. Then we heard another one. Sounded like they were calling back and forth to each other on the Kentucky side. We thought it was cool. Then we heard one sound off behind us deep in the woods on the Indiana side. I thought, that is weird. And it was time to go. I never thought anything about it. Then, the next weekend, we went to this small lake about 20 miles north of the Ohio River in Indiana to fish. It's in the Hoosier National Forest. We got all set up to fish, and I heard the same sound come from across the lake. I knew we didn't have elk in our area. I couldn't see anything. Across the lake, there was a big clearing from the bank to the trees that was about 50 yards wide. Whatever it was making that sound was in the woods. I got my kids out of there. We have been back since, but never heard or seen anything since. There are stories across the river in Kentucky about something they call sheep squatch, some Bigfoot-like creature with horns. I looked it up, and I found what some said it sounds like. It sounded just like what we heard at the river that night and at the lake. Made me wonder. All of this is true, but I have no idea what that thing could have been. Makes me wonder what could be out there. Keep up the good work. Love listening to the stories. And it's comforting to know I'm not the only one that had an experience like this. It also kind of helped just typing it out. Thanks, Joe. To Nance and the Buckeye Bigfoot Channel. My name is Rosanna. I never saw the creature, but I was in the periphery when this happened, and I did hear all the screams. I believe 100% what the person here told me that happened, because it all lined up with everyone else's story surrounding it, including mine, and you'll understand when I'm finished. This was in northern Minnesota. It happened at a private lake area where you can rent cabins up along the lake. It was July 2008. I had gone up with my new boyfriend and his friends. I had only been dating this guy for about 6 weeks, and these were his friends from childhood. It was my first time meeting them because they didn't all live in the same city anymore. There were six of us total, three couples. Me and my boyfriend Maurice, his friend Court, and his girlfriend Rochelle, and then there was Mike and Rhonda. First day there, the people in the cabin next to us walked over to tell us there had been howling and screams the night before. They said they found prints out on the other side of the lake that wound around their cabin. They said something was prowling their cabin in the middle of the night, and their children would no longer sleep alone in their room, but insisted on sleeping with them in their room at night. We didn't know these people. We thought they were just trying to scare us, because it all seemed odd the way they just came over out of the thin air to tell us all these things like we knew them. There they were, a family with young children, and here we were, a group of six young people who looked like we were probably going to be up all night drinking, which was actually the plan. We thought they just said all that to get us to maybe leave or move a cabin because they thought we were going to bother them. And we probably would have had they stayed. But turns out they said they were leaving early. And they did leave within an hour or so after telling us all this. There were other cabins out along the lake with people in them, but our cabin was at the end of that line of cabins. And between the cabin that those people next to us had just left and to the next cabin that had people in it was probably a football field's length. The distance between the sets of cabins was because of the topography around that side of the lake. There were some huge rock formations around the bend of the lake. You couldn't have put cabins there. That left a huge gap between the cabins, but you could still look down and see the whole shore. The first night there started quiet. We ate, and then we stayed up at a fire outside near the shore, drinking. We finally went to bed a little bit after midnight. We had actually started drinking beer early, and turned out none of us could stay up as late as we thought, because of all the beer. I woke up that night to the sound of one of the other girls screaming. It was Rochelle. Now, I thought maybe her and Court were arguing again because they had been giving little snide remarks and digs at each other all evening. All day, really. We all knew something wasn't good between them that day, and we tried hard to ignore it. It was uncomfortable all day because of them. But then I heard what was being said out there, and the hall light was turned on. I could see the outline of light around our closed door. Then one of the guys was banging on our door. I didn't know what was happening. My boyfriend got up and opened the door. There was a lot being said in the hallway. A lot was going on out there. Turned out, Rochelle said that she woke up and she realized that someone or something was looking in the window. She had left it open to get some night air. These cabins were very minimal in style. There was very little fabric in the whole cabin other than sheets and towels. There weren't even any scatter rugs. No curtains on the windows, just blinds. Rochelle had left the blinds up so she could look at the night sky while she fell asleep to the breeze coming in the window. These cabins do not sit flush on the ground. They're raised up off the ground, I assume, in case the lake waters rise. I'm 5 feet 7 inches tall. When I stood outside the next day by their window, I stretched up on my tippy toes, and I could barely touch the bottom of the windowsill with my fingertips. Now, whatever stood out there must have been 9 feet tall or higher. That side of the cabin had scrub grass growing right up to it, and you could see something had smashed down the grass in that area. Now, those cabins weren't far from the main bank of woods that wrapped all around that lake. Most was cleared all the way up by the cabins, but there were a few groups of pine and fir trees left here and there, I guess to make it look a little better and not so bare around the cabins. Our opinion was, someone was on stilts out there, some prankster going around and scaring people. Now that sounds really stupid and funny, I know. But someone 8 feet tall, looking in a remote cabin window, that's pretty stupid and funny sounding on its own. We had come to the conclusion that it had to be someone from the other end of the lake with just a little too much time on their hands while the circus was on summer break or something. Okay, we were kidding about the whole circus thing, sort of. We really did think it had to be somebody who knew how to use stilts who had the chance to pull the prank of a lifetime off. I mean, wouldn't that be funny? We eventually went back to sleep that night. But within that hour, we were all still awake and we all heard the screams out in the trees behind the cabin. "We should call the police," someone said. But we didn't, because the guys assured us that it was just some animal out there screaming. I tried to believe them, and I tried to go back to sleep, but that screaming went on and off all the way to daylight. There was no sleep for me. The next day, we asked the people at the other end of the lake in their cabins, had they heard the screams? None of them had. But we were all the way at the other end of the lake on the bend, so we reasoned that maybe it was possible. They just couldn't hear it all the way down there. Day two went like day one. We stayed up even later drinking, though. The guys thought they were going to catch themselves that prankster. I couldn't stay awake anymore, so I went into the cabin to go to sleep. Not long after, I heard the other two girls come in as well. I don't know what time it was that the guys came in, but it was pretty late. They said they heard and saw nothing while they were out there. But within 15 minutes of them coming in, the screaming started. They turn on all the lights outside of the cabin, and they go out. We girls asked them not to do that, but they were all acting brave, and they started walking around the cabin with a flashlight and calling out to whoever it was. While they were out there, the one guy named Court, he got hit hard with a rock. I mean hard. It hit the side of his arm a few inches below the shoulder joint. This was not some little tiny pebble tap. It was a big rock, and he ended up with a huge bruise that showed the exact outline of where the rock hit him. It turned incredible shades of navy blue, purple, yellow, and green. He got hit really hard. He said he couldn't see where it came from. But the other two guys were standing within just a few feet of him, and he knew it wasn't them. And we three girls were in the front room of the cabin together, so he knew it wasn't us. That left the prankster. They came back in, and we heard screams on and off till daylight again. Day three. The six of us were all exhausted. None of us had had much sleep, and we hadn't had a lot of fun, other than a few nights of sitting out and drinking by the fire. But even that came with its own chilled worry. Like the other people who talked to us when we had first gotten there, we were talking of leaving early. And by now, yes, by now, that famous word, Sasquatch, it was being tossed around. One of the other girls started using it first and said that was what was out there and that we should probably leave. The three guys just poo-pooed her, saying it was all BS and there was nothing happening out there other than a prankster. But the more she talked about it and the more she laid out what she knew about Sasquatch, the more it seemed like it could be a possibility. I mean, is Sasquatch any more improbable than some circus person on stilts out there running around a lake at night? I mean, no matter which way you went, Sasquatch, crazy weirdo on stilts? Well, it sounded like a bunch of Hollywood movie BS. We said, let's stay one more night and see what happens. It was quiet most of that night. We thought maybe we got lucky and whoever it was, they had checked out and gone home. The guys had gone fishing that day, and they had managed to catch some fish. They had trimmed them out, and we roasted them outside for dinner. Well, all the stuff that they cut and trimmed off the fish, they tossed out by one of the great big fir trees not far from the cabin. I say they, but it was actually Court that did it. I saw him do it, and when he did it, I said, "That's not a good idea. That could attract a bear or something." He didn't like that, and he laughed at me and said I was being stupid. But Mike said the same thing and backed me up. But Court got mad, went over, grabbed a grocery bag, put it over one hand like a glove, and began picking up pieces of the fish that he could and put them in another grocery bag. Then he tied that bag up and dropped it in the trash can out there on the porch. I started to open my mouth again, but I could see he was already in a bad mood, so I wisely kept my mouth shut and went over and told my boyfriend Maurice, who then went and got it from the can out there. And by the way, that trash can wasn't supposed to be out on the cabin porch. The guys had brought it outside from the kitchen. So Maurice pulled the bag out of the trash can, walked over to the tree line way behind the cabin, opened the bag, and dumped it. When he got back, he said, "Well, that must be where everyone dumps all their stuff because, oh my, it smelled awful out there." Now it's starting to get dark, and the guys are talking about sitting up out on the little cabin porch all night to catch this prankster. We said we would sit with them. Only problem was, everyone kept talking, and talking would keep whoever away because then they'd know we were out there. So we all agreed that we were going to sit in the dark and not talk. Well, you know what was going to happen. You're in the dark, in silence. Sooner or later, you will start falling asleep. I was going in and out of sleep. I would start to go to sleep, and then I would shake awake, remembering where I was and that I was outside unprotected. One time, I did get to deep sleep, and I don't think I was the only one. We're out there, in the dark, all sleeping in our sling chairs on the porch. Now, whoever it was, they must really not have liked Court, because suddenly in the darkness, Court yelled out, "Ow!" And immediately we heard something hit the wood floor of the cabin deck. Court had been hit by another rock. We all start scrambling out of our chairs. At the same time, we could hear something running away. The pounding footsteps on the ground were clear. And it must have been very near the cabin when it started running, because the sound was close, and when you could hear it move from near the cabin, brushing through the trees out back, all the way to the wooded tree line. The guys had decided enough was enough. They were going to chase down whoever this was. We asked them not to, but all three boys were off that porch like rockets in the night. We girls went inside and did the only thing we could do, which was wait. Then we heard one of those awful screams like we had heard the last several nights, only it sounded like it was right outside the front door. I jumped straight out of my chair. We all did. A few minutes later, we started to hear the guys yelling. They weren't screaming like they were being killed, but what we heard wasn't their normal voices. We three girls were just looking at each other like, "What do we do? What are we supposed to do?" Well, the only thing we could do was sit tight and wait. When the guys finally came in sometime later, they were clearly very shook up. I asked Maurice, "What happened out there?" And he kept shaking his head, saying, "You wouldn't believe me. You're not going to believe me." I kept saying, "Try me." And this same conversation was going on with the other two couples. They were saying the same things to each other. The guys were shook up, and they didn't want to say what they had seen out there or what had happened. And to me, that was scarier than what they finally did say. And this is what they finally said happened. They were out there, and none of them were armed, by the way. The only thing they had was a flashlight. They were thinking, really, in their head, they were about to get into a knockdown, drag-out fist fight with some guy. Never did they anticipate they were about to run into Mr. Squatch himself. Or it might have been herself. I don't know. They didn't know either. The guys always said him or he and sometimes it when they talked about what they saw. They had gone out to the tree line way out back, which was the sound of where whoever it was had ran to after Court was hit with the rock on the porch. And he was starting to take that very personally, by the way, because this was his second time to get hit by a rock. and when he was hit, Court was neither in the middle of the group on the porch, nor was he on the edge. Thinking on it later the next day, when Court said he thought that he was being specifically targeted, we all began to wonder if maybe he wasn't right. We don't know why, though. There was someone angled sitting in front of him in a chair on the porch. So whoever hit him had to aim right between two other people to hit him square in the chest like they did. Now, it might have been pure luck in the darkness with that throw. Maybe. But none of us have a theory as to why it continually targeted him. But back to them being out in the dark in the trees. They're shining the flashlight all around, just knowing they're going to catch some weirdo out there. They were planning to beat the ever-living crap out of him. Those were their words. They were frustrated. They were exhausted from lack of sleep, and they were angry that they were not getting exactly the kind of love from us ladies that they had planned on getting that week. Why? Because we were all tired, cranky, and too spooked for any kind of lovin' because of whoever this prankster was. So yes, they were going to beat the ever-living snot out of him, to use another form of their words. On the way out to the tree line, Mike had bent down and picked up a rather large fallen branch. He said later that it was instinctual. They were heading out there into the darkness, possibly to do battle. He saw it, and he picked it up. That turned out to not maybe be a good idea. Court had the flashlight, and he's in the lead. The other two guys are clustered around him. Mike has the tree limb, and he's holding it like a bat. Mike said it then felt like another baseball bat hitting him right across his back from behind. He gets hit hard. He goes down, and he's eating dirt. He later says that he didn't know what was happening. All he knew was he heard the other guys running away. They didn't even scream or yell. They did not stop to help him or pick him up. He said he had had the wind knocked out of him. He had been hit so hard. His eyes are open in the darkness while he's laying there, trying to get his breath. And then he starts to freak out because he realizes the guys ran away with the flashlight and he's alone there in the dark. Except he's not alone and he knows it. He said something is standing very close to where he's laying. He can hear it breathing. He can smell the musty animal odor. When all this is over, and he got to come out of those woods, Mike didn't even try to hide that he peed on himself right then. But right then, he said he didn't move when he realized he was not alone, not a muscle. He said he played pure possum. What he next felt was he thought a bear nosing him to move him to see if he was still alive. And that's why he played dead. He had always heard, play dead if a bear attacks. Something nudged him on his side just below his rib cage. Then it nudged again, even harder. But it didn't feel like a bear snout or a bear paw. He couldn't figure it out. But he kept telling himself to stay stiff. Don't move a muscle. He said he was even holding his breath. He was terrified. He was alone in the dark with something big nudging him to see if he was dead. Then he heard his name being called from the edge of the tree line. The other two guys were out there yelling for him. Before they had made it all the way to the cabin in their panic, they realized that Mike was still out there and that they couldn't just leave him. So they gathered up their courage, and they had gone back. When they were standing on the edge of the tree line calling for Mike, that's when we heard them from while we were inside the cabin. They're shining the flashlight, but it doesn't go as far as where he is deep in the tree line. But he says that while laying there, he could see the light over that way, and he could see that they were coming closer. So, too, did whatever it was standing there by him. He saw the outline of the legs when the light shined behind it, he said. He could only see from its knee area down, but he saw the fuzzy fur in the light. Lots of things were going through his head right then, and he said he was wondering where the rest of the bear was. Why was it up on two legs? Then the word Sasquatch came down into his brain, and he was the one that had poo-pooed it the hardest the day before, by the way. That, he said, is when he pissed himself. Now the other two guys are coming back into the tree line to look for him. They finally got their guts up to go help him if they could, facing whatever they had to. And I guess them coming back is what made the Sasquatch leave. We don't know. We've tried to understand, but nobody has a guess as to why it walked off after hitting one of them. We speculated that the reason it hit Mike is because he saw it as a threat. Mike was the only one carrying something weapon-like, as in the big tree limb. Mike said that he expected his life was going to end right then when he first saw the big legs move. He thought it was raising its foot up to stomp on him. But instead, it walked over him. He heard and felt it walk away through the ground vibrations. Mike said he was holding his breath for so long that he had begun to see white spots out in the darkness, almost as if he was about to pass out. When he started breathing again, he tried to yell, or at least that's what he called it. To the guys coming into the trees, they said it sounded like a weak baby calf bawling, not at all like a grown man yelling for help. They got to him, they got him up, and they were going to help him back to the cabin because they thought he was hurt. Well, what do you know? Karma's a bitch, as they say. Because once on his feet, Mike did a turnabout as fair play, and he shot like a rocket through those trees all the way back to inside the cabin. The guy stood there, they said, for another half second before they started following him. He got into that cabin, and he was so frightened he locked the cabin door, turned around, and looked at us three girls wild-eyed. Then we heard the banging on the door, which scared us terribly, until we realized it was the other two guys. He let them in. At that point, that is when we clearly saw that Mike had pissed himself. His pants clearly showed the dark outlines. Can't say I blame him. Of course, we all agree that it's time to go ahead and get the heck out of here. We're not going to stay any longer. We did try calling the cabin management company, but at that time of the middle of the night, we only got their voicemail. We told them we were going to vacate early, and they could call if they want for details. We were talking about calling the authorities, but it really felt like a bizarre thing that nobody was going to believe. Mostly, we just wanted to get out of there. We were already packing and got out of there right with the sunrise. Mike never changed his pants until we were leaving, and only then because Court told him he could not get in his car with urine-soaked pants, which were still wet-looking. Over the hours, while waiting to leave and packing for the ride home, we heard what happened from each of them in turn, and we were all comparing notes with one another. Sure, we had heard of the BFRO, and we were thinking of contacting them, but then we felt foolish, and then we got afraid. It wasn't our property, and when the management had contacted us back about leaving early, we told them what happened. That's when they started screaming at us and telling us that we better not be spreading any of those kinds of rumors and we better not leave a review mentioning any of that or they would come after us with lawyers. Did we understand about libel laws? So we didn't contact anyone. Now I know there was really nothing that they could have done to us. We could have posted all the reviews we wanted. We could have told the whole world. But that 22-year-old that I was at the time, I didn't know that. I had no money and I was scared. The whole mention of lawyers and lawsuits, that scared me. So no, we didn't call anyone. I didn't know what they could and could not do if I did tell anyone. We were all young, poor, and easily silenced. The one thing that Mike said over and over was it was one thing to be frightened laying there when he thought it was a bear nudging him. But it was quite another level of fear when he realized that it was really a Sasquatch checking to see if he was dead. He says the way it just stood there after it kept nudging him made him believe it was waiting to see if he was going to move or not. To Mike, that spoke of intelligence. It was reasoning. It was thinking. And he feels that if those other guys hadn't come back for him, that Sasquatch would have carried him off. Beyond that, he refuses to speculate about why or what would have happened. Now that was the one and only time that the six of us were ever all together. I never spoke to the other four really again after that. I think once they might have called my boyfriend's place when he was showering and he told me to answer the phone. But that's it, because me and that guy, we didn't make it another couple months. It had nothing to do with that weekend. It's just, no matter how hard you try, sometimes things don't work out. Thanks for letting me get this off my chest after all these years, and I'm not worried that anyone is going to come after me about libel, slander, or any of that now. Thanks, Rosanna. Well, that wraps it up for another night. Now, I don't know about you, but if I have a nightmare tonight, it might be about those red glowing eyes from the first story. Or it might be about being nudged by a Sasquatch to see if I'm dead. Well, the only other thing that I have for y'all tonight is an email I received, and I thought it was interesting enough that I wanted to share it, so here it is. Nance, I noticed you recently had a story which suggested our friends spoke a Native American dialect. I think this may be a fact in British Columbia. Perhaps you could get some indigenous residents of that area to share this possible situation with you. If the Indians of this area and the Sasquatch shared a language, they might also have some folklore to share with us. Good luck. Love your show. So how about it? Anybody out there from the BC area? You guys have any folklore you might want to contribute and share with us? I mean, if so, we all want to hear it. Send me an email at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. I know I would be interested, and I can guarantee so would everyone else. All right, everyone. Well, that's it for tonight. Whew, I got to tell you, I'm ready for a nice tall one. It's a long one tonight. Now, don't forget, I'll be in Gatlinburg, Tennessee this July 24th, one day only for the Smoky Mountain Bigfoot Conference. I'll be sharing a booth with Mr. Dixie Cryptid himself. So stop on by and say hello to both of us. You know, when you're out there in between the incredible lineup of speakers they have this year. If you look up here on the screen, here are the listed speakers so far, and I took this directly off the convention's website. Oh, and just a truthful disclaimer here. Neither me nor Dixie Cryptid are associated with this conference in any way. We don't personally know anyone there. We're not getting anything for being there or talking about it on our channels. We paid to have a booth there just like everyone else. We just got ourselves a vendor's booth and went halvesies on it. We did it because we thought it would be a fun way to meet a lot of you. That's all. So I just wanted to put that out there because I've had more than one little nasty gram of an email telling me that I need to disclose when I have affiliations or paid placements. Well, this isn't an affiliation, and it sure is not a paid placement. Nope, none, zilp, zilch, nada. We paid to be there, not the other way around. So I just want to say, if y'all haven't gotten your tickets yet and you want to go, I'd love to see you, and I know Cam would too. So hop on over there and get those tickets before they're all sold out, because it's not that far off now. As always, I'll put a link in the description below if you're interested in going. All right, everyone. Well, I know it's sad when it's over, but it's not really over. It's just over for tonight. We'll be meeting up again real soon. And until we do, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.